Hey guys, welcome to our channel. We're going to take you today through unboxing traps all the way to getting them ready to put in the dirt, guarding a dirt hole or a T-bone set ready to catch fur. So we're excited about bringing this video to you. One thing I did notice in the editing process is that I cut this video probably 6-7 years ago, and I've changed a little bit of my methods. Some of my equipment I've updated. So I wanted to take just a quick second and show you that. You'll see in the video that I use El Cheapo 2995 Bass Pro Shops turkey fryers. And I have since upgraded to this $93 Gas One 200 turkey fryer. It's just a propane grill. It has a huge burner on it that is actually even staying lit in the wind while we're sitting here talking. I know it's windy out here, but this thing is phenomenal. I can control the height of the flame so much better on this. It's so much more sturdier. You'll also see that I went to a double boiler method in how I melt my wax. In the video I'm going to show you, I just put the wax straight on the Bass Pro Shops turkey fryer and try to regulate the heat somewhat. Much safer method, guys, is to do this. I got a cast iron pot here. There's a 1-inch trivet in the bottom that keeps the stainless steel stock pot off the bottom of the cast iron pot, and that allows the water to freely circulate around there. And when I bring that water to a boil, it can encompass or encircle that wax all the way around and bring this safely to a heated temperature, and don't have to worry about scorching through the bottom of that stock pot, okay? And the last thing I'll point out to you is, we mentioned in the video, I talk about leaving the wax, you know, leaving the traps in a wax for 5 minutes or 10 minutes, whatever. It's really not time dependent, guys. What you're looking for, when I pull this trap out, you'll see that this wax is crystal clear. It looks like this trap is wet. It doesn't look like a milky white or something like that. When I first drop a trap into this wax, in fact, let's do that. Let's drop a trap, just gonna put it in here right now. Before this trap takes on the temperature of the heat of the wax, see how milky white all that is? Okay, if I leave this trap in here longer, that trap is gonna eventually get as hot as the wax. When that happens, it'll get crystal clear like that. So that's how you know when a trap is ready to pull out of wax, is when it gets clear. See how this chain is already getting really black and clear? That chain is getting hotter than the trap. So that's how you know when to pull the traps out of the wax. And you'll see that those traps also are KO Juniors, really super like those. I talk about Bridger number twos, and I run them all on my line, guys. I've ran MBs, I've ran Bridgers, I've ran, I've run about everything. So, but my go-to trap these days are these KO Juniors, phenomenal trap. But whatever out there is get you catching fur, just get outdoors, take a kid with you, and we'll see you on down the line. So what I have here, guys, is I have about a half dozen brand new Bridger number twos. I'm going to put a few of those out. Move that out of the way so we can talk about this a little bit. So this is actually one of my favorite traps that I use. I run a lot of these on my line. Bridger number two is actually made by a company, Minnesota Trap Line. And what you'll see here is, if you start looking at some of the parts, this trap has actually been base plated. So there's an extra plate welded onto the bottom of this, really fortifies it and strengthens the integrity of the trap. It's also center swiveled. So the swivel is welded into the center of the trap. A lot of the ones that you see at a Bass Pro or a Tractor Supply or something like that, where you see more of a generic version of a trap, you'll see the swivel is over here on the side. When it's base plated, you'll anchor the trap down in the dirt with what we call an earth anchor. I'll show you how that works later on. But it's held down in the ground, and the cowdy is pulling. If it's a cowdy or a bobcat, typically we talk about cowdies, they can exert a lot of pressure and force on a trap. It's pulling directly from the center, and it's not allowing him to twist. Also, you'll see these MD crunch proofs. Cowdies they have a lot of PSI on their bite, a lot of pounds per square inch they can put on a bite. And these are called crunch proofs because any lesser swivel can actually crunch. They can actually cave it in with their bite. It's amazing, the power of a cowdy bite. But these are heavy duty J hooks, the swivels. You'll notice this is actually double swiveled. And the reason for that is, as a coyote lays there, a lot of times they will flip, they'll turn, they'll twist, they'll jump. And any direction that a coyote wants to move with this trap, he's not going to injure his limb. He's not going to break off a paw. He's not going to hurt anything. But one of the things I'll show you when we're out on the trap line, as I'm getting ready to set this trap, a lot of times what I do with landowners is I'll actually set the trap, and I'll just stick my hand right in it and show them that it's not going to injure their paw. It's not breaking limbs. It's not doing anything like that. One of the reasons that helps with that, you'll see this 3/16-inch rod that's welded onto the top of the jaws. What that does is that doubles the thickness of the jaw, of the holding surface, and it helps to dissipate the pressure that's put on their paw. Think of it like this, if you want to go to an extreme example. If I take the blade of that knife and I slam it against myself, I could cut myself pretty easy. If I turn it sideways, the blunt force of that blow is dissipated, is spread across a lot more area, and it doesn't hurt it as much. It's the same thing with this. By having this jaw laminated, it helps dissipate the pressure on that paw and just helps hold them firmly there. Let's look at some of the parts on a trap. So this is the pan. The pan is the area where the target animal is going to step and close the jaws on the animal. This is called a dog. These are the jaws right here, and the levers are actually what brings up the jaws and closes it onto an animal. This trap is actually what's called four-coiled. You'll see four coils that help power the jaws closed, and that serves a couple purposes. It adds to the speed of the trap, especially when we're targeting bobcats. Bobcats are extremely quick. When they feel anything move at all underneath their feet, they can jerk out so quick that the four coils helps tremendously. Compare that with, this is a trap that I've already dyed, waxed, everything else. This is an MB550, which I run a few of these on my line as well. But notice there's only two coils here. There's nothing on this side. This is a two-coil trap. This is a four-coil trap. So you want to think of, compare, this is actually called a coil spring trap. So actually the coil springs is actually what powers this trap. A lot of people that aren't familiar with trapping, this is what they think of when they think about trapping. This is a double long spring trap, and I got this one out to show you the differences. This is what you'll see in a lot of old hardware stores, sometimes a Cracker Barrel, things like that. The old trappers, this is more reminiscent of what we would think of as a bear trap. But these right here, that's your springing action, and that's what powers the jaws shut. So that's a double long spring, coil trap, here's your pan, here's your dog, your springs, jaws, and levers. And always run at least two swivels, guys. A lot of times I'll run three. But if you notice, here's what the next step is after all that explanation. See how my hands are? The manufacturers put a coating of oil, and it's just kind of gunky. They put that coating of oil on there to keep the trap from rusting before it makes it to the end user, before it makes it to the trapper. It keeps the trap kind of looking nice and pretty, so when we get it, kind of eye appeal, it looks great. The first thing we need to do with this trap is throw it in a dishwasher. I know that sounds crazy. You can do a lot of other things. You can take it to a car wash and power wash it. You can dunk it in mineral oil, let it sit for a day or two, then throw it out, because we want this trap to rust, and the manufacturer has coated it so it won't rust until it makes it to us. But we as the end user want it to rust. That's so that it will accept the dye and turn that trap black. It's not necessarily a necessary step, but tradition-wise, and I like it, if my pan becomes uncovered with some dirt gets away, and we'll show you that on the line, if the pan becomes exposed, you don't have that shiny trap sitting there. You've got a black trap, and it's a lot harder for the animal to see. But we're going to take a second and throw these in the dishwasher right now. Okay, gang, so we've got everything unpacked. I kind of showed you the little parts and bare essentials of the trap. And again, one of the things that a lot of people find kind of incredulous a little bit is the first step, throw them in the dishwasher. And literally, I'm showing you this because a lot of people don't believe it, but just load them into a dishwasher just like this. What this is going to do is remove that slimy, greasy coating that comes on it from the factory. That's going to allow us to prep the trap as necessary. So just load them up in the top here. Slide them in. And you could probably just run it through a rinse cycle. I've always thrown some soap in it as well. Get started.
Okay guys, forgive me for the wind. I know the audio is probably gonna pick up some noise, but I did wanna get back with you and show you that I am gonna have to add some white vinegar. This is distilled white vinegar from Walmart. It's $2.50 for a gallon, so it's very cheap. But the traps that I put in the dishwasher, they are, if you start to look at it, they are starting to rust. I want to speed up the process a little bit, and so I can hurry up and get these traps in the ground, especially for this season. So what I'm gonna do is just dump them in a 5-gallon bucket here, and literally just pour the white vinegar straight on them. What that's gonna do, I'm gonna let them sit for probably overnight. That's really going to kind of etch into the metal just slightly and really expedite or speed up that rusting process. Again, it kind of seems funny to a non-trapper or someone who just spent, you know, $25 per trap on these expensive traps that we really want to rust them. But that slight surface rust is what we're after, and we'll show you what that looks like probably tomorrow. And what that's going to do is allow it to really take the dye, and the dye will set in it, color it the way, the color that we want it to. Okay gang, so here we are. We're back a day and a half later. We took our traps that we just got in, brand new, out of the box. You remember how shiny they were? They were coated with grease, a little bit of oil to keep them from rusting before they made it to the end user. And as I mentioned to you, we actually want some rust. Obviously the manufacturer doesn't want to send them to you rusted. They can't control how long they stay on the shelf or how much they rust before they get to you, so they leave it up to the end user or the trapper to do the rusting. So what we did was we threw them in the dishwasher, and then I brought them outside and I let them soak in white vinegar. I actually let them soak overnight, and this is a day later. You can see once we removed the grease and the coating of oil that the manufacturer put on and let them sit out for a day, they've got a really nice surface coat of rust on the trap. And what that's going to allow us to do is that will allow us to dye the trap, and the dye will actually soak in and take and hold onto the trap, and it won't just wipe off as it would if it were a chromoly or a stainless steel or something that didn't have something to stick to. So what we've done is we've got our Bass Pro Shop turkey fryer, $24.95. Any turkey fryer will work from your local hardware store, Walmart, wherever. And just a stainless steel pot that I bought from Big Lots, and $10 or $15. Fill it full of water, and I've done a couple different methods. I've used actually black walnut hulls. That works well. It's free. We actually have several black walnut trees right behind us. The tree house behind me is actually supported by a huge black walnut. But my actual favorite method, believe it or not guys, is a commercial method, and this is just a logwood trap dye. I don't know, it's $6 or $7 for this bag. And you open it up, and just dump it right in. What I like about this, guys, as opposed to the black walnuts, the black walnut actually will turn the traps black, and then, like I said, it's free. But as you're handling the traps, especially before you can get them waxed, you get black all over your hands. This logwood trap dye actually adheres to the trap, soaks in very well, coats it completely black, as you'll see. And it doesn't come off on your hands. So really like it. I'll show you kind of how this works. Literally, you just take it in, throw it in. And we're gonna throw all of our traps in. And I usually put as many as I can get in so that it'll sit comfortably and soak all the way. That's going to be about the max for this batch. We've got about three or four traps in. I didn't keep count, and we'll let them soak for an hour or so. Let them boil in there really good, and then we'll put our remaining traps in. And speaking of that, ran the line this morning. Had a beautiful red fox waiting on us. We had freezing rain move in. If you can see it over my shoulder, had a lot of ice sticking to it. But bad thing is, you can see this fox got a little muddy when you catch them and it's rained. You're gonna have a muddy animal waiting on you, so we'll clean him up before we board him and hang him on the wall. So anyway, hope this makes sense. We'll take you to the next step here in a second. Okay, gang, so we're back at the next day after dyeing the traps. But what I thought I'd do is take one of these and show you exactly how I make my Earth Acre setup. I've done this for almost a decade. It works extremely well. And I'll walk you through the process. So this is what I actually use as an Earth Acre. This is a finned super stake. You'll see the fins on the side with a retrieval boss built in. And this is the retrieval boss. And I'll show you the purpose of that when I get it built here in just a second. So I typically take 3/32 aircraft cable. I've got a short little expanse of it here. And I keep a tape measure out just so I can kind of make them consistent. You'll need a pair of aircraft cable cutters. And I make mine about, I found if you can cut it at about 16 inches long, this stuff cuts extremely easy with aircraft cable cutters. You'll see that. I actually ordered this from a trap supply store. So we've cut our aircraft cable to about a 16 inch length. What that's gonna allow me to do is have the whole apparatus about 12 inches once it's finished. So this is a 3/32 inch aircraft aluminum double ferrule. And it has two holes almost like a figure eight, just big enough to slip the aircraft cable in. So you can slip it in, put it on the boss of the stake. This is actually called a disposable stake, and you'll see why I like these, because I actually don't use them as disposable. I don't leave them behind with the retrieval boss. You're able to pull them really easily. And again, they probably make a special little tool to crimp that easily. I found it's really easy just to set it on the ground. Grab a normal claw hammer from your hardware store and pound it shut. And there is no way that thing is coming undone. It is on there as solid as it can be. So what we're gonna do is grab another 3/32 aluminum double ferrule, stick it on here. We're gonna attach it to our J-hook. Now you wanna make sure to put a second J-hook in here. A lot of times when you get it from the trap supply store, it's gonna come with this J-hook that attaches it to the chain. And then there'll be a swivel here and a hole. Don't put it through the hole there. You want to put another J-hook in here so that you have double swiveling action at each swivel. And notice that, I think I may have mentioned this before, I've actually inserted a third swivel here. So there's one, two, three swivel points. And then with a J-hook on each side of swivel, there's actually six swivel points in here. So there's no way that a coyote or a fox or something that's flopping all around in your set is going to do any damage to its paw. This will allow it to move freely no matter what it does. So we're going to put the 3/32 cable through the J-hook, again, not through the swivel, but through a J-hook that I've added. And had it in the hole and let it slip out. So there we go. So again, if you've ever worked with galvanized cable, there will be a point where you realize you've got that loop too sharp, too tight. I've got it down to small without it really binding the cable too much. I just hammer it shut. That right there, guys, I'm telling you what, that will hold my Can-Am four-wheeler in four-wheel drive. I cannot back that out like that. So what you do is you drive it down, there's a stake driver, and I'll show you this on the line here in a little bit, but you insert a stake driver, drive that straight down into the bottom of your trap bed until just that part is sticking out. When you pull this, watch that turn sideways. So when I pull it, it turns sideways. That's the action that's gonna happen out in the field. As you're pulling it, it's turned sideways. That is your holding power. See this retrieval boss built in right there? So when I attach a second cable to this, I can pull up on this cable, and I'll attach it here in a second. When I pull up on that cable, it turns it back on its end, and then I can pull it out the hole that I drove it down in. That's the beauty of this system. It's ingenious, it's simple. It'll hold a Can-Am four-wheel drive four-wheeler, but yet I can pull it out by hand when I'm ready to pull my traps. Okay, gang, so you'll see here that I've attached the second cable to the retrieval boss. And so what happens is you drive this down with a stake driver, drive it down, pull it up and set it. Then when you're ready to retrieve this out of your set, you pull on this cable, let me flip it over. So it's like that. You pull up on this and see how it pulls it right back up. So you pull that up and then the whole thing can come straight up. I also leave this cable slightly longer than that cable, and you'll see why in the field. When I'm driving that down, down the hole in the trap bed, and then it set that. See how that sticks up just slightly? If this was down here level with this loop, if that loop was shorter, if this whole cable was shorter and this loop was down here, it would be really hard to get anything in that loop to pull it out. So I leave that loop just slightly longer so that when I'm pulling my traps, when I'm done with a line, I can find this loop real easy, pull that, and it all comes out easy. So that's a normal setup for me. It also makes it real easy to drop in wax or anything. And you'll see how black these traps are. Actually, it is coming off of my hands just a little bit. That's fine. Once I get wax on them, I won't touch them again anyway. But all of that black will be contained in there. So I will tell you this, the dyeing part is not absolutely necessary. I like having my traps black so that if they get uncovered at all, it's black. It blends in with the earth a lot more. But the waxing part, what I'm about to do right now, and right now I'm heating my wax up, so we'll wax the traps here in just a second. I'll show you how that goes. The waxing part to me is a non-negotiable. It protects the integrity of my traps. It keeps them from rusting more than I want them to in the ground out there in the field. It makes them a lot quicker. It speeds up the process of the action of the jaws and the trapping action itself. It also contains any scent that's on the trap before I put them out in the field, and it keeps any scent off of it that it would otherwise collect. So waxing is, to me, is a non-negotiable. The dyeing part, some people like it, some people don't. It's more of a, what are you willing to do? What steps do you want to do before you take your traps out? Waxing, to me, again, a necessity. Okay, moving on to the actual waxing part. So you'll see the advantage of actually having the anchor system attached, or even a cable extension like I've got on those, is you want to be able to dip them into the wax and leave something out to retrieve them by to pull them back out. Talking about the wax, you'll see again, we're just using our normal cheap turkey fryer that you buy from any local hardware store or Bass Pro. Again, a stainless steel pot from Big Lots. And the wax you can actually buy, they actually sell trapping wax at the trapping supply stores. And again, taking nothing away from small businesses, I love supporting small businesses, but you can buy this stuff extremely cheap from Hobby Lobby in 10-pound blocks of 100% paraffin wax, which is the exact same thing. It's not called trapper's wax, but it's 100% wax. And if you download, you can actually go to hobbylobby.com on your smartphone as you're in the checkout line. Download a 40% off coupon, and while you're there, you can get it not only at a great price, but then an additional 40% off on top of that. And I actually buy, I bet I've got 20 or 30 pounds of wax in this thing. I don't know. I'd have to do the math to equate what a quart equates out to, but there's several 10-pound blocks in here. So all I do is dip it in here. And again, the process that probably takes the longest is heating the wax up slowly. I don't want to scorch my wax and give it a scent. So I actually heated it up extremely slowly, brought it up to temperature. It's just simmering. There's little small bubbles just barely coming up in it. And I'm gonna put every part of the trap, including the last swivel, in and let it sit. So the key here, guys, is a lot of people, you'll see different methods of people want to leave a film of wax on top of water and dunk it through it and pull it back up through the wax. That whole bucket is full of wax. And I leave it in there and I leave it submerged until the trap itself actually takes on the temperature of the wax. So I'll leave it in there sometimes 20, 30 minutes. That's probably overkill, but at least a good 5 to 10 minutes. Let it sit there and actually acclimate and take on the temperature of the wax. And then when you pull it out, now this is too early, but when you pull it out, you want it to be 100% clear. See how that trap is actually really shiny from the wax. Now, you can see it's a little milky right here. That's why I let it stay on a lot longer, but it's close, actually. So if I left it in another 5 to 10 minutes, there would be no qualms, no worries, that I've got a good, secure adherence of the wax to that trap. But I don't like how it's milky here, so it's gonna go back in, and we'll leave it in there for about 10 minutes or so, and I'll show you at the end what it's gonna look like. Also, one of the things that you'll notice, and I neglected to mention, I actually stuck a nail in between the jaws. And what that does, that allows that trap, that wax, to get completely inside and all around the jaws of the trap. And when I open the trap in the field, that part is coated with the wax too.
Okay, gang, since last time I was with you, I was able to go ahead and put five. That's one reason I love using this size pot. I can put five traps in there at once, a couple, three batches. I'm usually done with the load that I'm doing there. Let's go ahead and pull the trap out that we were looking at here. And of course, it's at the very bottom of all that I put in. But notice how the wax runs clear. Even on the trap itself, it's clear. And what I'll do is I'll take this and underneath the deck, I have a bunch of nails pounded in, and I'll go hang this up, let it dry, and she'll be ready to put in the ground. So that's all there is to it.